Welcome to Ring of Fire, I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. John Kasich has thrown his hat into the GOP circus ring, so we'll check out his record and see where he stands compared to the rest of the field. The right-wing noise machine has become a megaphone for Republican hate talk. We'll explain how this mechanism is making race relations in the U.S. so much worse. And scientists have now linked income inequality to low test scores among children. We'll bring you the details in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up tonight. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Ohio Governor John Kasich is the latest Republican to join the crowded campaign field in their race to the nomination. We now have 16 different candidates on the Republican side, all vying for a single spot on the 2016 ballot. Kasich's announcement came at a time when the rest of the GOP has already bruised one another fairly regularly, leaving Kasich one of the few who is not too bloodied up to fight. Kasich also has the benefit of not being a household name at the moment, with relatively little media attention being paid to the Ohio governor during his tenure in office. This means that he might not have as many questions to answer about his record as other candidates, and in a Republican primary, that's certainly a good thing. Where Kasich struggles is on race issues. The few times that Kasich has been discussed in the media or when he's tried to prevent African Americans in Ohio from making it to the polls by restricting voting times at precincts, cutting early voting hours, and enacting restrictive voter ID laws. All of these efforts were designed with one goal in mind, and that was to keep Democratic-leaning minorities from making it to the polls. With racial tensions playing a major role in this election already, Kasich's preference towards an all-white male electorate will likely present problems for the governor as he tries to appeal to voters outside of his home state. Kasich also tried to recreate Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker's assault on public unions, a move that caused his approval rating to plummet and caused Ohio voters to pass a referendum undoing the governor's actions. However, it was enough of a gesture to help him win the support of anti-union corporations. One thing that the governor does have going in his favor are his campaign donations. His two gubernatorial campaigns in Ohio brought in more than $39 million, showing that he clearly has the chops to raise money for a campaign. His top donors are exactly what we would expect to see. They include lobbyists, banks, oil and gas companies, insurance companies, and pharmaceutical companies, which tells us that Kasich is another run-of-the-mill conservative. But again, that could actually play out in his favor as he seeks the nomination. He doesn't reek of crazy like Trump, Cruz, Perry, and Paul. He doesn't have the baggage of his relatives like Jeb Bush. He's not a bully like Chris Christie, and he's not a novice like Marco Rubio. So even though he's tried to keep African Americans from voting and tried to destroy unions, he is still sane enough among Republicans compared to the rest of his party that he might actually have some staying power here. He also has the benefit of a home state advantage in Ohio, a state that has gone to the general election winner in every race over the last 55 years. That fact weighs very heavily on the minds of the Republican establishment. The media is already falsely claiming that Kasich is a moderate, a move that will inevitably attract true moderate conservatives who aren't fired up by Trump's racism or Ted Cruz's nuttiness. But as long as the media says he's a moderate, conservatives are going to eat it up, regardless of whether or not it's actually true. Even with his horrible policies that have adversely affected minorities and wage earners, Kasich still has the potential to make it all the way in this Republican primary, and that is absolutely a terrifying thought. In other news today, scientists have discovered a link between income inequality and low test scores among adolescents. Past studies have shown that there is about a 20% gap in test scores between low-income students and middle-income students. Most recent data shows that this gap in test scores is the direct result of the income gap between the classes. The link is due to the inability of lower-income families to provide adequate nutrition to young children, which in turn affects their brain development. Scientists have discovered that children born into poverty have delayed or reduced development in the frontal and temporal lobes. Study looked at brain images of different classes of children and did not include any children who are at risk of poor brain development due to other factors. So to sum things up, the study only looked at otherwise healthy children who have been exposed to nothing more than income inequality to find out the problem. Scientists have known for a long time that there was a link between lower test scores and poverty, but they say that this new study finally adds the missing piece to this puzzle. This should also serve as a wake-up call to politicians who continue to ignore the realities of income inequality. But why focus on real problems when you can focus on make-believe ones? That's exactly what the Christian right is doing right now. After being handed a very strong defeat with the Supreme Court's ruling on same-sex marriage, the Christian right didn't have to search for too long to find a new group of people to hate. Their latest target is liberal Christians. Christians are furious at religious progressives for teaching things like the virtues of scientific discovery, tolerance, caring for the needy. So they're lashing out and demonizing any Christian who actually follows the teachings of Jesus. As Think Progress points out, this new crusade against liberal Christians is extremely hypocritical, given that religious conservatives are constantly whining about the left's alleged intolerance towards their religious liberty. But to me, it also highlights a growing problem with religion in general, which is the fight to remain relevant in a changing world. Pope Francis has brought new life to Catholicism by embracing things like climate change and rejecting the rampant inequality being caused by unrestrained corporatism. And even non-Catholics are beginning to see that you can be both religious and progressive and even believe in things like evolution and climate change without compromising your faith. Fear is the only way that the Christian right knows how to control their followers, and if they had to admit that they were wrong for so many years about these issues, they would lose support and credibility among their fear-based followers. So they do what they do best, which is to attack those who are different from them and to tell their followers that these people are not true Christians, which only serves to prove that today's Christians have completely abandoned the teachings of Jesus Christ. We'll be right back.
Ring of Fire is always on. Radio, YouTube, social media, and news. The news stories that matter to progressives are always available at ringoffireradio.com, along with commentary, interviews, and so much more. ringoffireradio.com.
Donald Trump is still surging in the polls thanks to his appeal to the racist base of the Republican Party, but Trump's comments on immigrants were only possible because of the right-wing noise machine, a machine that has been tailored to specifically drum up the fringe of the Republican Party on issues like race. Joining me now to explain how this works is political commentator and essayist Chauncey DeVega. Chauncey, Fox News is responsible for basically creating the Donald Trump that's out there telling us that Mexican immigrants are going to kill us or rape us or both or whatever the hell he's trying to sell us these days with his hateful agenda. But the root of it really does come down to Fox News. They're the ones who have pushed racism through America because it's great ratings for them. They know that their base absolutely loves it. And now it's being personified by somebody like Donald Trump and in worst cases, people like Dylann Roof. And so, again, I don't want to say that Fox News is responsible for this, but it's kind of hard to argue that they're not, isn't it?
Absolutely. With Dylann Roof and Donald Trump, we have the hate that the right-wing hate media produced. So if you listen to Donald Trump, for example, his talking points are verbatim, taken from Fox News and other right-wing websites and media outlets. And what really, really concerns me, and I wrote about this over at Salon.com and my own site, ChaunceyDeVega.com as well, is that if you look at the overt formal white supremacists, not the apologetic ones, not the colorblind white racists that form the base of white racially resentful folk in the Republican Party, I mean folks like Stormfront and elsewhere, almost point for point, Donald Trump and Fox News on many issues are mainstreaming those hateful and pernicious attitudes. So this really is number one for Fox News, because they're not news. They're a right-wing propaganda operation to begin with. So we don't want to call them news. But in terms of how they're affecting the public discourse, it's very, very dangerous, because Donald Trump, for example, in his recent complaints that Mexican immigrants are raping and killing white women, well, that has very, very, very dangerous consequences, because for a lot of the public, that's weaponizing them. That's an implicit appeal to violence. Because when white women are raped and attacked and killed, what do? You defend them. So this is very, very irresponsible behavior.
And, you know, we've seen in recent months several prominent conservatives, conservative pollsters, conservative strategists come out and say, look, Fox News is actually hurting our party. And it is issues like the Dylann Roof terrorist attack that are they're pointing at. They're saying, look, this is the anger that Fox News breeds, and it's the anger that people like Glenn Beck and Alex Jones also breed, because that anger is manipulated by racism. You know, whether the Fox News hosts themselves hold racist beliefs is one thing, but they do know that saying racist things is how you drum up the Republican base, and that's how you get people like Donald Trump to win support. And I wholeheartedly believe right now that the reason Donald Trump is polling at the top of the conservative polls is because he is out there parroting those Fox News talking points. And as you've pointed out in your piece from Salon here, they're not just little talking points that he just comes up with on the fly. These are well-focused, well-refined. The man knows exactly what he's saying when he goes out there, doesn't he?
He knows exactly what he's saying, so we can run down some of his claims. So he's making implicit appeals to old white anxieties about crime by black and brown folks. Never mind the data tells us that white women are among the safest groups in this country. And in terms of Donald Trump's claims about white women being raped and killed, that tragic case in California, for example, well, the fact is most folks will suffer crime from their domestic partners and people they know. And the GOP has a real problem because Donald Trump is speaking to their base. That's why he's polling so high. Now, he's not going to win. This is just a reality TV show for him.
Right.
But the mainstream Republicans are terrified that he's exposing what good, smart folks of conscience have known for some time, that conservatism and racism in the post-civil rights era are one and the same. And that's why he's so popular with the right-wing base.
And so, you know, let's take it back to Fox News in general, too, because Trump is not their only creation. You know, as you pointed out, they've also talked about these roving gangs of black people out there who are just looking for somebody to rape or kill, just other forms of overt racism that come out of this network on a daily basis. I mean, you know, they may as well have, you know, white hoods on their head when they're doing these TV shows, because when you really listen to the language, the words, the talking points that they're spitting out, there is no other way to describe it other than just purely racist.
And it's totally ungrounded from reality. So Fox News and the right-wing echo chamber, there's a term that social scientists have used called epistemic closure. It basically means these folks are talking to themselves about themselves and have created their own fictional universe. Here's some other great examples that viewers and others who don't traffic in what I like to call the right-wing public sewer, so the right-wing online sites, white supremacist sites. Bill O'Reilly recently did a show about white privilege. And what he was saying was that white privilege is somehow hostile and racist towards white people like him. Well, that's a talking point that's directly taken from white supremacist websites, where their quote is, anti-racism is anti-white. Here's another great example. A few years ago, Fox News was 24/7 for a week talking about this knockout game phenomena, where they were claiming that feral groups of black young people were running around attacking white people. Well, it's not real journalism, and it wasn't true. It was basically the result of a Google search, and you can put in keywords and call that journalism. But as you said, and you, as you smartly pointed out, Fox News is mainstreaming some of the most noxious and dangerous white racism and white supremacist talking points, and they need to be held accountable.
And this is happening all throughout the right-wing echo chamber, because, again, they know this. We've got to go to the lowest common denominator. That's what they figured out. How do we get people energized 18 months away from an election? Because, look, Donald Trump is not going to be able to ride this immigration card for 18 months. But he's throwing out the red meat now for those really fringe, crazy people, you know, at the very bottom of the barrel, because they will stay energized about it. And so Donald Trump and other Republican candidates can move on to other issues, but they know they've already given the racist thing. They've got those people. And that's what the right-wing echo chamber is built for. It's built to appeal to that lowest common denominator with, you know, the worst possible policies. And we've seen them also I don't want to say take up arms, but, you know, get overly defensive of people like Cliven Bundy. They think it's remarkable that he and his followers out there, you know, took up guns and pointed them at federal agents to stand their ground. Now, you and I have personally discussed before, but if those were African Americans or if those were immigrants or anybody who wasn't a white, you know, guy pointing guns at federal agents, Fox News would have been calling for us to go drop a nuclear bomb over in Nevada to take care of these people. I mean, there's a huge double standard within this right-wing echo chamber. And to me personally, I don't think this is a winning strategy. I mean, they cannot continue to alienate over half of the country and expect to continue to win elections, can they?
Well, that depends now. Are they thinking about running fair and equal elections? Of course not. But we know that one of the strategies, again, right out of the white supremacist playbook, they have written extensively about this. Go to their websites. Is you shrink the electorate. You make sure that the poor can't vote. You make sure black and brown folks can't vote. You make sure that now they're going to go to the Supreme Court and change how voting districts are created to actually shrink the electorate and overrepresent red state America. So for folks of conscience who believe in the common good, who believe in a we the people democracy, no, this won't work in the face of changing demographics. But if you're the Republicans and you can shrink the electorate and you can make sure that you're using the politics of white racial resentment and disinformation, because again, going back to Fox's news, it's not news, it's disinformation. That's what the whole right-wing echo chamber is created to do. And you can mobilize the white racially resentful base, well, they may have a frightening chance.
And to me, one of the most ridiculous things that I've heard, especially on Fox News, they said, look, if these people can't afford, you know, to get an ID, then what do they do when they fly? Do you really think that these people who can't afford to get a driver's license are flying all around this country? I mean, that most people don't go get on airplanes. I don't understand what they don't get. But again, it's these simple little talking points that most people don't take the time to flush out in their own heads and say, that's true. If you don't have an ID, you can't fly, so you can't not have an ID. No, most people are not flying. Most people are not traveling. They're not taking vacations. They're going to work and they're going home. And that's what the Republicans don't understand, because the echo chamber pushes these disinformation, I guess.
I mean, the Republican Party right now in the right wing, it's a war on the poor. It's a war on people of color. It's a war on women. And I'm going to make a desperate plea. I've written about this on my website when I talked about the Confederate flag. And we've sat down before and chatted about the Confederate flag and Ring of Fire and Free Speech TV. Is taking down the Confederate flag is a symbolic act. People need to get beyond the magic trick and stop and start asking themselves, why would the Republicans give up that symbol? And as we said last time, sometimes you sacrifice a pawn to save a queen. People need to stay engaged and mobilized and take on the very issues you suggested. Voting, take on Republican efforts to roll back the civil rights movement, and try to stop this war on the poor. Don't fall for the magic trick, because the symbolic victory matters, but we need to have substantive victories as well.
You know, I want to shift gears really quick here in the last few minutes we have. Over this past weekend at Netroots Nation, both Martin O'Malley and Bernie Sanders were confronted with the Black Lives Matter activists. Both of them, I was not there. The headlines have said both of them really had no idea how to react, and it's hurt both of them at the moment. As far as Martin O'Malley, I don't know that he had as much of a chance as, say, Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders' momentum at the polls had been huge. What do you think those two could do or should do to reach out to the African-American community? Because we know that Hillary Clinton has huge name recognition, very credible among African-American communities. But I think, you know, as far as populist policies, Bernie Sanders, obviously, his policies are going to benefit many, many more people than Hillary Clinton's would. So what could he and Martin O'Malley do, you know, to kind of fix this horrible image that they don't care about to the African-American community?
Yeah, I mean, yes, it's race and it's class. So Bernie needs to broaden his narrative to speak very directly to that. He has the record. And African-American voters are very sophisticated. So one of the issues that Bernie Sanders and any other third party candidate are going to have to overcome is a lot of folks are going to say, you know, the game is rigged for a two-party system. First past the post, victory. So we don't want to waste our vote. And you're absolutely right in terms of actually looking at Hillary Clinton's record, right, in terms of neoliberalism, in terms of the types of policies she supports. But I'm going to commit what we call an act of, in Greek, they call it paresia. speaking truth to power without fear of consequence. I think within the African-American community, I have a lot of empathy and love for the sisters and the Black Lives Matter movement, for the folks who disrupted the Netroots meeting. But we need to play chess, not checkers. Some of these conversations need to happen in private. Some of these conversations need to be about the threat of action as opposed to direct action until absolutely necessary. Because when the sisters got up there, and again, I have nothing but love for the Black Lives Matter movement, they actually gave the Republicans and the GOP a visual that they can use to mobilize their voters. So I suggest to Bernie and to other folks who are, again, forward-thinking progressives to talk about race and class together. It's not one or the other. And I think if Bernie Sanders and others can sit down in private and dialogue and have both parties or three parties or four, everybody getting in the room and talking about mutual shared self-interest, because Scott Walker would be hell on earth for this country for poor Black and brown folk. The Republicans would be hell on earth for poor Black and brown folks in the working class and the middle class. So we got a lot of issues we can overlap with, but we got to really be smart about how we use direct action and how we play the political game.
Chauncey DeVega, ChaunceyDeVega.com, The Chauncey DeVega Show. I absolutely love talking to you. I would talk to you every single day if I could. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you.
Last week, an oil train derailment in Montana leaked 35,000 gallons of crude oil into the environment. This was just the latest railway disaster involving either an oil train or a passenger train in the last 18 months. And there's a very good reason why we're seeing such a huge spike in train accidents, and it's because the rail lobby is incredibly powerful in Washington, D.C. Mike Papantonio recently spoke with attorney David Haynes about this issue, so let's take a listen to what they had to say.
You know, it's amazing, David, the Amtrak industry, as a matter of fact, the entire rail industry, it's almost inconceivable that, A, they don't want to keep their anything up to speed. I mean, the infrastructure is dying. The Republicans are making sure that's dying. But then the second thing is they want immunity when they kill people. This is what's developed here. I mean, tell us the story about the two things. First of all, we know they're not safe to ride. And then second of all, if they're not safe to ride, should they be given immunity where you can't sue them when your family's wiped out on a rail car?
Isn't it incredible that we have another tragedy on our nation's railways late Tuesday night of last week? And then Wednesday, the Republicans are literally on the floor of the House rejecting a Democratic amendment to spend more money to improve safety control, specifically the positive train traction safety mechanism, which would have prevented this incident. And so the infrastructure is dying, as you say. High-speed rail is in Europe, Asia. We're not only are we not upgrading to that, we can't even maintain what we have. If positive train control would have been on this section of track in Philadelphia, this would have never have occurred. This train wouldn't have been able to go over 50 miles an hour. Yet the Republicans have reduced spending by one-fifth of Amtrak spending in the bill passed last Wednesday. And so it's just a terrible situation.
Well, they want to privatize it, and that's what the GOP does. Every time they want to privatize the post office, they dry up the money of the post office. They want to dry up education and privatize education. They dry up the money to education. They want to privatize Amtrak. They dry up the money, hopefully making the argument that, gee whiz, somebody can do a better job. They now want to, you've seen it with even the public parks. They dry up money to take care of the public parks so they can allow the public parks to be bought by their money donors out of Wall Street. So it's a pretty well-known MO. But in this case, I think that it's deplorable that not only are the Republicans helping the rail industry allow their infrastructure just to fall apart so they can take more on the bottom line and they can make a bigger profit by not taking care of anything. They then are saying, you know what, if everything goes bad and we kill 100 people, then the most that railroad's ever going to have to pay is $200 million. Did I get that right?
You did. It's rather incredible, but the families are facing that cap. We were involved in a tragedy down here in D.C. several years ago, Fort Totten. In Chatsworth, California, there were 25 killed, numerous seriously injured. There is a maximum total cap, no matter how many deaths or how many catastrophic injuries, of $200 million for all passengers, no matter the situation, anywhere in our country, if it happens on our nation's railways. This was a cap that was put into place a number of years ago when President Clinton was in office. It was sponsored by Senator Kay Bailey Hutchinson. Your viewers will remember her from Texas. It's no coincidence that she accepted over $350,000 from the rail lobby. So this cap has no accommodation for a cost of living increase or anything else, the cap is still in place and it must be removed, as well as improvements must be made.
Okay, so let's just make it clear. If 150 or 200 people are killed or maimed in an Amtrak kind of collision, a disaster, a catastrophe, call it what you want, then the money that all of those people can get for their medicals, for their future wages, for anything, for everybody included, all in one big pile, is $200 million. Is that right?
That's correct. And for some of these serious injury cases, their future medical costs alone, just for one person, will be in the eight figures for some of these folks, not to mention the death cases and many of these individuals were wage earners providing for their young families and so forth. So this is a very egregious law that's on the books that must be removed. Of course, we never want these tragedies to happen in the first place. But as you point out, to allow them to happen for failure to invest in infrastructure and then turn around, it's salt in the wound to these families to say that there's a limitation because you happen to be riding on our nation's rails.
Okay, so where we are now is you have, ultimately, if you have 100 people seriously injured and there's not enough money to go around, you have taxpayers who now have to take care of medical bills. They have to, if the people are disabled, they have to take care of that disability. So what the rail industry does is shifts all that responsibility away from the people making the money, which is the rail industry, and that responsibility then shifts to the people that are simply taxpayers that have to make up that difference. Isn't that where we're left?
Essentially, you're right. I think you're making the point there'll be an added burden on the healthcare system for people won't be properly compensated for the negligence which occurs on the rail. The rail lobby in Congress is tremendously strong. They have put in $1.9 million, I believe, in the last cycle to many members on the Transportation Committee. And so this is a cap that needs to be removed. We need to have better safety conditions, so hopefully we can have, too many times we're having these tragedies in our country. This is a rail line I was riding on with my wife the other weekend, you know, up and down the Northeast Corridor. It's heavily traveled. We need to know that we're going to be safe on these roadways. It's just unacceptable. For Republicans to try to privatize, it seems to be the answer to everything. But you know, we need this. This is a quasi-governmental situation with Amtrak, and Congress needs to make the appropriate investment. And when people are injured through the negligence of Amtrak, then they need to be fully compensated.
Okay, so in this situation, let's talk about Metrolink. We got a couple of minutes. Metrolink was a case where you had just horrible, catastrophic injuries because the engineer, rail driver, was texting while he was driving the train, and it ended up in hundreds of people being injured. Okay, so the judge is then in a situation. You got hundreds of people injured. You got people that are paralyzed, will never walk again. People are blinded. People with such catastrophic injuries that they have permanent brain damage. So this judge is then having to say, okay, I got $200 million that I have to split up among these people. It's almost kind of like a Sophie's Choice kind of decision, isn't it? The judge says, I don't know. Who makes the decision? Does the guy with the brain damage get the money, or does the child who will never walk again get the money?
It's a horrible situation for that federal judge to be in the Chatsworth, California case and some of these other cases where he has to make a terrible situation knowing that a lot of these individuals are not going to be properly compensated. Those who have lost their loved one and are without a wage earner and a member of their immediate family are not going to be properly compensated. And members of the general public are just not aware. This could have been any of us, any of our families. As Vice President Biden mentioned, this could have been anybody on the train. And your viewers need to be aware that appropriate civil justice is not available in these situations, that you are basically going to have to be put into a matrix with hundreds of other people, and the judge is going to have to figure out how many pennies on the dollar you're entitled to because of this cap that the Republicans keep insisting on keeping in place.
And the rail industry that's paying off people, senators and congressmen, you know, $300,000 here, $200,000 there, they get to keep all their profits and pass all the risk on to the taxpayer. Wow, isn't America great? Thank you for joining me, David, okay?
Thank you.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can always get the news that the corporate media won't cover on our website at ringoffireradio.com and on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftTV. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week.